opening up the phone lines for listeners Q&A.
Hey, Chris, Marcus here. I really enjoyed your conversation with Bob Foy on this week's show. Couldn't help but wondering when you and he were discussing Bitcoin cryptocurrencies and looking for a digital currency moving forward that politicians and bankers can't mess up. I couldn't help but thinking about the Kinesis project that Andrew McGuire and Tom Coughlin are working on. Just curious to get your thoughts on whether or not you think that concept that they are moving forward with using a bullion backing to their token, if that could potentially fit that niche that we're all looking for. So thank you very much. I really enjoy all your hard work and the great shows. Thanks.
First up, longtime listener and friend of the show, Marcus, starts off today's discussion with comments on Andrew McGuire and CEO Coughlin Kinesis project. That's a gold-backed cryptocurrency, a project down under that's caught the attention of many bigwigs in the precious metals and financial community. You know, Marcus, I appreciate the kind words and the question. According to GoldSeek's top brass, Peter Spina and his folks, Kinesis is above board. We're supporting and continue to expect big things from the Kinesis team. I'm posting their latest project paper in PDF format, which I highly recommend people thoroughly study. So you can find that either on the main GoldSeek Radio page or our Nuggets page. One key caveat, and we have to include this whenever we're talking about really anything. So this is nothing directed specifically at Kinesis. It's just many of my longtime listeners know we cannot be too careful. You know, initial public offerings and ICOs involve extremely high risks, as again, we learned last year. Here's an example. I started off a few years ago with the Komodo ICO. It was a stealth currency, had an excellent underwriter at Smith and Crown, which I highly recommend bookmarking that website. It turned out to be one of the best performers in ICO history from its 50-fold opening price, first day price, to about the same as you would have paid pre-token, you know, pre-ICO. So you could say that since the tokens were locked up and could not be sold off, it was a wash. Later, the tokens did skyrocket back up even higher, but for most of the people involved, it was too late. Here's the key takeaway point. In most cases, it's safest to wait until an ICO goes public and let that organic price discovery, the market forces, the invisible hand, let that reveal the true value. Here's another case in point. Like many of my colleagues, I was extremely interested in the SALT, S-A-L-T lending platform, ICO. Allows everyday folks to just take their currency, their Bitcoin, Ethereum, whatnot, convert it into Bitcoin, and then borrow against it with a unique, highly dynamic margin slicer, I call it, which instead of getting a margin call some morning, it'll just slice off a little bit of the Bitcoin you've deposited if the price were to drop below the margin amount. They were very legit, vetted every single American user, spent thousands of hours making sure everything was above board and legally compliant. Nevertheless, the price mostly fell. After the ICO, it did bounce back, I think, to the opening price, and to this point, it's still in recovery. Would love to see it bottom out if it hasn't already. Haven't looked at it in a while. Unless you can get in at pre-ICO offering price, I think they usually refer to this as the beta level. I've got to be a proponent of waiting until after the ICO, watching the weekly chart bottom out. Now, there is another option I have for a lot of my listeners here. If you have extra time and you'd like some free ICOs, I have a list found that you might not be able to find yourself. Now, it might take 20 to 30 minutes or even more to get those free ICOs. But once you get accustomed to using some of the phone apps, some of the phone messaging apps, I think you'll be ready to go. So just send me a message at gsr@hughes.net. GSR@Hughes.net. I'll fire that over to you, and I'll try to remember to post the link here, but I really prefer to stay in touch with my folks. So if you really want the link, I have it bookmarked. Just send over a request. Thanks again, Marcus. Next up, John, now in sunny San Diego.
Chris, listen to the latest installment of GoldSeek Radio, and you seem rather skeptical of a deflationary crash. Personally, I think there's probably going to be a mixture of two, deflation followed by hyperinflation. But I just heard an interview with Charles Nenner on USA Watchdog, and he is committed to the deflationary scenario and he says that the stock market will not crash until 2020. Whether Nenner is right on this one or not is, of course, speculation. Maybe you want to have Nenner on to hash this out with you, because you seem very skeptical of the deflationary scenario. Personally, I don't think it matters all that much. Deflation, hyperinflation, whatever. Gold is going to go up once the you-know-what hits the fan and they lose control. The physical market will break the back of the paper market and discredit New York and London, and all the gold seekers will move over to Shanghai or Hong Kong or somewhere else in Asia. Wherever the gold is flowing, that is where the buyers will go. They can't get their gold in New York right now. Anybody that wants the gold, as you probably know, they're being directed to London to get their gold. Either New York doesn't have any gold or they're sitting on it and they don't want to surrender any. So I don't know what's going on at the COMEX, but this exchange for physical gambit, certainly suspicious. I think you would agree. Anybody would agree. Why would the COMEX direct futures buyers who stand for delivery, why would they direct them to London? Why? There aren't very many answers to that. They're either they don't have the gold or they don't want to part with it. Those are the only two answers. Let's see what he has to say about all this. As you probably know, the yield curve is as flat as a pancake presently, and some pundits say it's going to invert, and that portends big changes in the financial sector in the coming months or weeks. So, as you know, the bond market is the key to everything. The price of money is always the key. So, because things are starting to look very dicey in the bond market. All right, thanks. Great show. Keep up the good work.
Hi, John. You know, Charles Nenner, solid friend of the show. In fact, he's scheduled to be back on the show, but he was in Israel at the time, and it was a little too costly at that time. We hope to have him back on soon, along with David Gurwitz, our favorite rabbi. As for the COMEX situation, you know, we've heard for years now from the Ghana folks that there's simply too little gold to cover the contract, something like maybe 1 ounce for every 100 contracts, and I've seen worse, 150 contracts. James Turk regularly warned our listeners for over a decade that a potential force majeure could unfold at any point that could maybe even send sort of a domino-like effect rippling through the gold exchanges around the world, from London to Frankfurt, New York, you name it, Beijing, Shanghai. You know, I probably need to bring this up to Bix Weir next time he's on the show. He's done considerable due diligence, if I remember correctly, in this area. You know, I've been talking about the flattening of the yield curve for several months now. I've regularly outlined my expectations for the short end to eclipse the longer end by summer of next year. And that, of course, as the Fed wraps up its rate hike cycle, which we currently expect looking at the St. Louis Fed's Fed funds futures. We're also seeing the EU, China, and Japan turn a little more hawkish, raise their rates, and follow in the Fed's footsteps. I believe that's going to put the greenback eventually under some pressure. As money flows, global, big global money flows in the Forex towards the yen, yuan, and euro instead of the dollar in anticipation of higher yields. It could also put some pressure on U.S. stock market. I think as soon as January, February of next year, we might just see some pressure come in, obviously after the January effect and tax-related selling. Maybe it'll wait as long as sell in May and walk away, which is the more traditional time to see weakness in U.S. equities. However, markets like the Nikkei, the DAX, and the Shanghai, I think, could benefit. So that's something to keep in mind because there are ETFs. Higher rates are the death knell for the longer end. So I agree with Boston University professor Lawrence Kotlikoff that you're going to see much safer, maybe even returns on the short end of the bond market in your T-bills and T-notes, as opposed to your longer 10 and 30-year bonds. Great questions, John. Next, it's Trent.
Hello, Chris. Hi, this is Trent, and I'm an ambassador from the SoundDeck.io blockchain. SoundDeck allows for artists to create royalty payment smart contracts on the blockchain. Any person who creates audio content can earn crypto tokens based off how many users stream their content on a daily basis. The blockchain takes care of storing all the streaming statistics and calculating the rewards. The reason why I'm calling you is because it would be a good recommendation, and basically you could earn some crypto from that. And then other users that have maybe they're musicians and they have some recordings, they can actually post their audio content and not have to even go through a record company to actually earn some royalties. For more information, you can visit SoundDeck.io. That's S O-U-N-D-A-C smartcasthere.io. If you go there, there's instructions on how you can upload your content and create your smart contracts for royalties. If you have any questions, you can contact me at 704-865-0234. And at 704-865-0234. Thank you.
Hi, Trent. It sounds interesting, and potentially it could, I think, you know, ignite a creativity revolution as artists have greater incentives to, you know, share their best work. And I'd suggest that though people do their due diligence here, as always, I don't know if this has gone ICO. I'm not following it. All the earlier provisos and caveats on ICOs apply. Hat tip for bringing this up to us. Certainly sounds like something worth investigating. I'd point out to everyone that we are in a bear market in the crypto space. And until that changes, which we've seen some signs of life come back into Bitcoin over 7,300, but I want to see Ethereum come back to life too. If we can see that, then typically, and we get over that 10 to 12,000 point on Bitcoin and march back to the former December 2017 highs, then it might be time to start looking at some of the other tokens and coins out there. But again, Trent, thanks for bringing it up. Keep listening. And we'd like for all of you to share enthusiasm for GoldSeek, SilverSeek, and GoldSeek.com radio. It's really word of mouth that helps us so much. And by doing so and signing up for my newsletter, the Alpha Stocks newsletter, where I give you my regular favorite gold stocks, silver stocks, as well as a portfolio of extremely scientifically balanced portfolio each week with solid betas. But more importantly, it's that alpha that gives you the boost above the typical portfolio that you try to put together. I started in 98. It's almost 2019. Honed this scientific process using proprietary algorithms as well as some proprietary software. So if you want to know what the computer thinks and what the computer is investing in, be sure and sign up for the Alpha Stocks newsletter. Also, that's where I put all of my latest crypto insights, favorite ICOs, topicality. So you don't want to miss out on it. And plus, we're giving away a free crypto wallet when you sign up for an annual subscription. You don't have to subscribe if you don't. You can just buy it 1 year. If you want to, or do it monthly, or whatever you like. Sign up, you go 5 years to 10 years, I give you about $100,000 in the testnet Ethereum, which is already worth, believe it or not, worth some real Bitcoin. And one day we think it could be as valuable as Ethereum is right now on the testnet. It wouldn't hurt to have 100 Ethereum I'm giving away with every 5 year, 3 year, and 10 year new subscription on the testnet, plus some other neat crypto assets, which I think is going to be a $10 to $100 billion market just in of itself. Just think CryptoKitties and crypto pets. We're giving away crypto pets to our 5 and 10 year and annual subscribers. So if you've been on the sidelines, if you've been on the fence, why not sign up? Thanks, folks, for calling in. Coming up after the break, more GoldSeek Radio.